And it's my pleasure to welcome you to a program featuring Michael Copps, who is the former chair of the Federal Communications Commissioner and Commission, and now heads the Media and Democracy Reform Initiative at Common Cause. Joining in the conversation will be our own Professor Andrew Lund. We gather in the homes of Eleanor and Franklin Roosevelt and Franklin's mother, Sarah. Sarah built these twin townhouses and gave one to Franklin and Eleanor as a wedding gift in 1908. The New Deal was shaped within these walls. And if you haven't, tour around the second floor study and see where Francis Perkins was recruited to the cabinet, where Franklin Roosevelt made the commitment to her to start a Social Security program. This is really literally where the New Deal took shape. The houses came to Hunter in 1942 after Mother Roosevelt's death, and it was made possible by Franklin and Eleanor, who made the first gift to Hunter so Hunter could purchase the houses from the estate. The houses were initially a student center, but closed in disrepair in 1992. And thanks to the vision and determination of Hunter President Jennifer Rabb, the Roosevelt houses were saved. They were renovated 3 years ago and made into a public policy institute, which has three principal purposes. One is to offer undergraduate programs, one in public policy, the other in human rights. Second, the institute supports faculty research, bringing together faculty from across all of Hunter schools and departments. And third, the Institute offers a robust program of public discussions, bringing the public together with policymakers to talk about the critical issues of our time. And I think Franklin and Eleanor would be pleased that we're meeting in their home tonight to talk about the perils that media consolidation poses to our democracy. And if you can, just look for a moment behind you. And you see the four freedoms engraved on the wall, and freedom of expression is prominently there. In fact, the first is freedom of speech and expression, said Franklin Roosevelt. He understood that a healthy democracy depends on an informed and engaged citizenry. Here are his words in a 1940 press conference at his other house, the weekend house upstate, not the heart of the Roosevelt life here in the city. So Franklin said, "You might say there are certain freedoms. The first I would call freedom of information, which is terribly important. It is a much better phrase than freedom of the press, because there are all kinds of information so that the inhabitants of a country can get news of what's going on in every part of the country and in every part of the world without censorship and through many forms of communication. You will never have a completely stable world without freedom of knowledge, freedom of information." So said Franklin Roosevelt in 1940. And I think President Roosevelt would be concerned about current FCC proposals, which aim to loosen restrictions on cross-ownership of television, radio, and newspapers. Michael Copps has vigorously explored the over-concentration of media ownership, the influence of money in politics, the failure of the FCC to protect the public interest, the dangers of the cableization of the Internet. And he chronicles the results of these trends: less investigative journalism, vanishing local news, more opinions, but less evidence to inform the public's choices on people and policy. Michael Copps has been a creative and courageous advocate of media reform. He's going to share his ideas with you, for example, requiring broadcast companies to be relicensed more frequently and to be challenged to explain how their presentation of the news serves the public interest. And I have no doubt that the words Citizen United will come up in what he's about to say to you. In accepting the Four Freedoms Award in September 2011 from the Roosevelt Institute, not here, but another Roosevelt organization, Michael Copps echoed Franklin Roosevelt's cautions 70 years ago, and I quote, building news and information infrastructure that digs more deeply, gathers facts before shouting opinions, and affords expression to the many voices of this nation's wondrous diversity may be our greatest calling now. Our country confronts challenges to its viability in some ways reminiscent of the 1930s, making it a national imperative that every American be empowered with the news and information essential for knowledgeable decision making. Without that, the challenges go misunderstood, untended, unresolved. When our media, our press, and our journalism catch cold, democracy catches pneumonia. Dr. New Deal prescribed strong cures for the challenges of his time. Now we need the restorative medicine of reform in ours. That's a sample of the eloquence you're about to hear. Michael Copps holds a PhD in history from the University of North Carolina, began teaching at Loyola University in New Orleans, served as chief of staff to Senator Ernest Hollings for over a decade, was appointed Assistant Secretary for Trade at the Department of Commerce by President Clinton, and served on the FCC from 2001 to 2009. So we're going to hear from a real expert. It's also my pleasure to introduce, who you will hear in a moment, Professor Andrew Lund, who is director of the Integrated Media Arts MFA program at Hunter and a faculty associate at Roosevelt House. He received his BA, MFA, and JD from Columbia, where he has taught in the graduate program. He's a filmmaker of great distinction, having won awards, for example, one for narrative filmmaking at the 2011 University Film and Video Association Conference, which is the highest academic honor in filmmaking. He's been the producer of 9 featured films, widely praised by people like Roger Ebert, and is also a scholar, publishing important articles, and has 2 books underway now, one The Act of the Short Film, and the other moving from or bringing the short form to the feature film. So Michael Copps will open with his remarks, and then Andrew and Michael Copps will sit here and talk for a bit, and then open it up to you for questions, comments, and we hope lively debate. Michael Copps.
Thank you very much, Jonathan, for inviting me to come back to Hunter College for another visit, and particularly one held in this historic Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute. I always jump at any invitation that has the name Roosevelt attached to it, because as you indicated, Franklin Roosevelt has always been my hero, and I have this opportunity to visit with you in the house where Franklin and Eleanor actually lived, and as you say, important components of the New Deal were actually hatched, is something I will always treasure. I really appreciate it. I admire Franklin D. Roosevelt, not just for what he did, although guiding a suffering and uncertain America out of the Great Depression and then to victory in World War II puts him right up at the top in my book, but so too for how he went about the job of governing. He created optimism from despair, consensus from confusion, strength from national collapse. He had abiding faith in the good judgment of the people and a practical approach that enabled him to try new things. If they didn't work, he would try something else, because then, like now, no one has all the answers, although we've got a lot of people around who think they do have all the answers. But we still have a lot to learn from the approach and that wonderful combination of idealism and pragmatism that was FDR. And as a one-time historian, I would be happy to spend all my time this evening talking about Roosevelt's leadership and diving more deeply into the enormous challenges that he and we as a country faced. And it wouldn't be without profit to do that, because there are many parallels, political and economic, between Roosevelt's era and our own. And while we don't usually compare the severity of our situation now with what existed back in 1933. In both cases, the future was wrapped very much in uncertainty. Now, as then, there is no preordained happy outcome for America, no guarantee that we will regain the millions of jobs that have been lost, or the competitiveness that made us the engine of the world's commerce, and the understanding that we have to invest in America if we want America back. There are so many things for us to do, and I'm only going to mention three of them tonight, but I think they are three that go to the very core of our national challenge. Two of them I'm just going to outline, and we can talk more about. The third I want to spend a little bit more time on, and then we can discuss that in more depth, too. First, like Roosevelt, we must build the infrastructure that is necessary for us to regain our national muscle. Look at the roads and bridges and dams that Roosevelt built, and at his understanding of how the new nascent infrastructure of electricity at that time, electricity for everyone, everywhere, was the necessary jolt to jumpstart a stalled economy. Sarah Palin might say, well, how's all that infrastructure-y stuff doing for us now? And I think the answer is not so well. Many of those roads and bridges and railways and airports and public utilities that carry our commerce are deteriorating so rapidly that they will soon be incapable of supporting America's commerce and America's growth. Foreigners often come here and are amazed at the rundown condition, the antiquity, really, of what once led the world. And what about the infrastructure of the 21st century, broadband? We're number 16 in the world today in terms of broadband penetration. And the lackadaisical approach that we have had to getting high-value broadband out to all of our citizens everywhere, again, no matter where you live or who you are, has dramatically short-circuited the job of putting ourselves back together again. High-value broadband and the internet are supposed to provide the new town square of democracy, but they don't reach into nearly one-third of American homes tonight. And even when they do, they fall far short of the open and expansive and democracy-enabling tools that they are supposed to be. And you bring that up, and the answer you get is, well, sorry, we can't afford to invest in the future. We're going over the cliff. But tell me, please, how our country is supposed to regain its footing without feeding the muscle to power it. I believe future generations will look back incredulously at the short-sightedness that has strangled our public policy discussions in this country about our economic future for the better part of a third of a century now. I think they won't believe the narrowness of the discussion and the options and the lack of depth. The second imperative is to reassert, like Roosevelt, the public interest over the special interests. I spent more than 40 years now, 43 almost, in Washington, D.C., and I can say with confidence that the influence of big money is greater there today than when I went there back in 1970. And as someone who once practiced the art of history, I don't hesitate to say that never, even during the notorious years of the Gilded Age of the latter part of the 19th century, has money wielded more clout than it does today. Money buys elections. Money opens doors. It gerrymanders districts. And it often even writes the legislation that Congress and state legislatures and local governments vote on. And most of the time it does so anonymously, constrained by neither good laws nor a sufficiently inquisitive press. Who really sponsors those political ads on your TV brought to you by some high-sounding committee for Purple Mountain Majesties and Amber Waves of Grain? And don't you think people might react differently to that ad if they knew that it was actually sponsored by a chemical company refusing to clean up a toxic dump? The infamous Citizens United, I got there, decision, opened the door, as you know, to every kind of PAC and super PAC and corporate and billionaire and special interest and dark money sponsorship that the creative political mind is capable of devising. Yet Congress refuses, absolutely refuses, to require full disclosure. And even worse, the one agency of the government that has the authority to require that right now, the Federal Communications Commission, where I served for over 10 years, stubbornly refuses to exercise the authority conferred on it long ago by Section 317 of the Telecommunications Act, which says, basically, citizens have a right to know by whom they are being persuaded. You, every one of you in this audience, has a right to know who is trying to persuade you or by your vote. So to achieve reform, we at Common Cause are launching a new initiative called Your Right to Know, Transparency in Political Advertising. And I have an article coming out about this in The Nation later this week, a movement to try to get three votes at the FCC to do this. And I hope we'll talk more about this in our discussion, because it's something that can be done without an act of Congress. It can be done now. The challenge I really want to emphasize tonight, a challenge that I believe is more important than any that I have mentioned so far, is the need for a media that truly informs and nourishes our democracy. Campaign 2012 was a bonanza for media profits. Television is where the biggest chunk of that $6 billion raised in the elections went. Yet the campaign itself was basically a dry well for voters and citizens trying to cut through the shouting and the name-calling of one of the least illuminating campaigns I think we have ever lived through. As FDR might put it, and I would bring this quote to light again, when our news and information infrastructure catches a cold, I think self-government really does catch pneumonia. A functioning democracy requires an informed electorate, and that is its very prerequisite. For a long time, we had a press that held power accountable. They really worked to get the facts, spent money on real analysis, and pressed for truth. Much has changed, and media very often fails its first responsibility to provide citizens with the high-quality news and information and deep accountability journalism that we each must have if we're going to make informed decisions about the future of our country in a very complex time. Glitz replacing substance does not get us there, nor does opinion displacing facts or spin supplanting truth. And what a sad fact it is to have thousands of reporters, probably upwards of 20,000 reporters, who are walking the streets nowadays in search of a job rather than walking their beats in search of a story. How do we get there? A huge part of the answer is that media, like so many sectors of our business, fell in love with consolidation. In newspapers, radio, television, cable, a few media giants gobbled up independent local outlets by the hundreds, and to finance their megabucks deals, cut, combined, or closed newsrooms all across America. To show the barons on Wall Street, who provided the financing for these deals, how serious they were about being good stewards of Wall Street rather than stewards of, say, the people's airwaves. To make matters worse, broadcasters in markets across the country have come up with all sorts of new ways to skirt the ownership limits that remain on the books, joint operating agreements, shared services contracts, combining newsrooms so that one really starved newsroom does the work of what used to be two or three or four, one staff doing the same reporting for multiple stations in the community, same news. It's been a huge blow to media diversity. Diversity of viewpoint, critically important. Diversity of minority and female ownership, critically important. Who owns something has a lot to do with the diversity of viewpoint that goes out over that stations. And female and minority ownership as most of you know, is at abysmal levels. Racial minorities, according to statistics that just came out, own 2.2% of all full-power commercial television stations in the United States of America. Is it any wonder, then, that minority and diversity groups are so often portrayed in stereotype and caricature, and their issues go unaddressed? There's more to the story of how we created these consolidated behemoths, how moneyed interests nurtured relationships with regulators to purchase favorable treatment at supposedly independent agencies. For too long, regulators almost never found, and still don't, a merger that they don't like. And they spent years deregulating, wiping away hard-won consumer protections and public interest protections like licensing guidelines, and having a broadcaster go out as a conditional license and talk to people in the community about what kind of issues do you think need to be covered in this community? What issues are you interested in? Instead, the first question that regulators too often ask now, well, is this decision going to help Company A at the expense of Company B? Instead, the question ought to be, is this going to promote the public interest, promote an inclusive media? Is it going to enhance consumer protection? Aren't these independent agencies supposed to be consumer protection agencies? For all the gory details I've talked about, and we can talk more about this later, I suggest you take a look at Susan Crawford's new book just out called Captive Audience. And another one I read over the weekend, I don't even know if it's in the stores yet or not, Bob McChesney's Digital Disconnect. Both really great, both really disturbing reads, but well worth your time. Now here's a surprise. Presently, an FCC dominated by Democrats is on the verge of allowing even greater media consolidation, dusting off ownership rules eerily reminiscent of what we considered under the previous two Republican administrations, rules that were turned back by the courts, even frowned on by the Congress. And in December, thank goodness, public interest groups and civil rights groups like Common Cause and Free Press joined together with civil rights organizations and called on their members to sign a petition opposing this move. And almost overnight, there were 200,000 people who said no to more consolidation and yes to more diversity in the media. Yet the commission still seems on track to march on with this plan undeterred, to allow more newspaper broadcast cross-ownership, to do away with any constraints on radio and television ownership. All the more shocking because even the President of the United States, when he was campaigning for office, when he was a U.S. Senator, voiced strong opposition to more media consolidation and sent letters, and I have several of them in my file that I received as an FCC commissioner saying we have to have a reassertion of the public interest in our media policy. We shouldn't be tampering with media ownership rules until we understand the consequences of them on minority ownership and diversity of viewpoint on the public interest. So I would like to think that in his second term, he will take up these goals that he talked about back then. But we're going to start a little promises to keep campaign, just in case he needs a little extra persuasion to help him along the route of redeeming those promises. So right about now, some of you are probably saying, well, what's all this with Roosevelt and 70-year-old history and so much emphasis on old media like newspapers and radio? There wasn't even TV back then. Now we have not only television and cable, but we have broadband and the internet and all the new media. So why not just stop worrying, and surely the internet will provide the news and information that our democracy requires. Well, it turns out, I think, that the more things change, the more they stay the same. I love the internet. And as I mentioned earlier, the broadband it rides on is our most critical infrastructure challenge. And we do see great entrepreneurship and innovation and experimentation on the internet. Barrier to entry is very low. Anyone can speak. Events never before coverable can be flashed around the world in a millisecond. All true. But history shows us that just about every communication system travels down a similar road toward consolidation, controlled by a few, toward gatekeepers and toll booth operators more intent on making a profit than on democratizing information. See Tim Wu's great book, The Master Switch. Some of you probably have read it, for more about this. And you got to be realistic. The quest for market control is in the drinking water of free enterprise. It's the motive power of business, and that's not going to change. But what has to change is to reassert the public interest. If you're going to go through all of this deregulation and freeing up of business. And you see this happening, I think, in broadband as well as with older traditional media. Controlled by a few, most of the news on the internet really comes, over 90% of the news that you and I consume every day, maybe even higher than that, still comes from those traditional news sources of the newspaper and the broadcast television newsroom. Problem is, there's just so much less of it because of the problems that I alluded to earlier. And to date, we have not seen a model on the internet that's going to support the kind of really resource-intense journalism I think that our times demand. And I'm talking about being able, as an editor of a newspaper, to tell a journalist, take 6 months, take a year, go out and get this story. Don't worry about filing anything else or going on the internet, going, just go dig for the story. I don't think that happens very much. So what we could end up with would be a really historical tragedy. You have all this promise and potential of the internet, perhaps the most dynamic communications innovation ever, ending up, as you said, as a cableized internet. That's something to ponder. I began these remarks mentioning what I see as the greatest challenges facing America. There are many others. And I bet you I could go around this room tonight and ask each person what you consider to be the greatest problem facing the United States of America. And I'd get many different answers. One might say jobs, or the outrageous influence of big money that I talked about, or gerrymandering, or filibustering, or the plight of our schools and our teachers, 50 million people without health insurance, energy dependence, climate change, doors still closed to equal opportunity. The list goes on and on, and all of those answers are fine. But here's my point. None of those issues has a shot at getting resolved unless it's really covered, and really dug into, and analyzed, and exposed to the give and take of a dynamic civic dialogue and an uninhibited marketplace of ideas. Now, if you think current media is doing okay by your number one issue, fine. You don't have to listen anymore to me. But if you think the issue that's most important to you might just benefit from a little more depth of reporting, or independence of judgment, or a little more diversity of input, then you need to put the future of our media right up next to that other issue that's so important to you. I think it's that important. Maybe it's the most important of all. So when I retired a year ago, I knew I couldn't leave these issues behind. They were my passion at the FCC. They're my passion today. Fixing it, is it going to be tough? Of course it is. There's lots of power, there are barrels of money on the other side to defeat those of us who fight for media and democracy reform. And like any great reform, this one will be ultimately decided, I believe, at the grassroots by the people. And that's why I went to a grassroots organization like Common Cause to continue my work, and why I've also joined forces with Free Press and Public Knowledge and other public interests and civil rights organizations to try to take these issues to the people. And you can learn more about our Media and Democracy Reform Initiative at commoncause.org. Even in this era, when money commands so much influence, I remain convinced that people can make a difference. And I think history shows us that. Generations of reformers have shown us how to overcome, abolitionists, civil rights crusaders, women rights activists, consumer advocates, disabilities activists, labor unions, committing to a cause and challenging power grown too mighty and moving America forward. And I believe we can do that again now. Franklin Roosevelt achieved his victories because such groups were there helping him and sometimes, yes, prodding him, make him go even further than he himself might have wanted to go. But together they overcame. And I think now it's our turn to show that we too can overcome. So thank you very much, and I look forward to our conversation.
So while Michael is getting his microphone on, I'll just say a few quick remarks. I emailed a colleague, Bill Herman, who is an expert on media law, and I said, you know, I've been asked to moderate a conversation with Michael Copps. Do you have a few questions you suggest I ask him? And Bill sent me a syllabus with enough reading to last me until the summer. But one point that was very clear is he said, listen, Michael's a hero. And I'd never heard Bill talk like this in person or electronically. He's really a hero. And if you look at so many people in positions like he had at the FCC, and you look at where they go when they're done doing their government work, supposedly representing the people, they go to those high-paying gigs at the corporations that they were having to deal with in their former position. And I think it speaks volumes that you've continued to do what you were doing when at the FCC and are doing that work for with Common Cause. And I can just tell you that there's a whole group of people I know that we're very excited that you were going to be here, who really said, listen, he's a hero to us. And they're now working on expanding your Wikipedia page. So there you go. In a previous life, I was a intellectual property lawyer. In one case, I got to work, and we got to go inside Viacom, and I learned a couple of things. I never want to work near Times Square, number one. And I also learned a whole lot about Super Bowl commercials, which is probably on a lot of people's minds because the Super Bowl was just yesterday. We had to go in and look at what various companies that were related entities were paying for the commercials. And what we discovered was, who do you think was paying the most? Political ads. So it was really shocking. And because we had the Super Bowl yesterday, and most of the ads I'm watching, and I think this is very entertaining, I don't know what they're selling, but at least I'm watching. I think the problem with political ads is the opposite. You know what they're selling, but you just don't know who's selling it. So maybe you could talk a little bit more about this idea of, you know, opening a window on who exactly is placing that ad.
Well, I think that's what we have to do. As I said, I think citizens have a right to know who's trying to persuade them or bend their vote. And the fact that most of us learned as much or more about the campaign, learned is probably the wrong word, heard about the campaign more from these anonymous, undisclosed political ads than we did from real news, local news, national news, journalism, resource-intensive journalism, really is worrisome. So I think we need to do something on disclosing the sponsors of political ads, and to think that an agency exists who already has the authority to do that and has not taken advantage of that while we sit around and bemoan the fact, oh, we can't get anything through Congress, nothing's going to happen for the next 4 years. Here's something that could be done right now. If we can require that, if this was being broadcast on TV and there was a bottle of Coca-Cola here, and we say you have to have at the end of that program sponsorship identification, why can't we? There's a candidate sitting here who's backed by some special interest. Why don't we know that the special interest is sponsoring that candidate's ad or their own commercial? And I don't think you can have self-government. I don't think you can have democracy without that. That's so basic. I mean, that would be politics 101. You go on a TV with a message, tell us who you are.
So you're really wonderfully suited to tell us, you know, if the FCC can do this and it's so important, you were there, how come it wasn't done? What are the barriers to making it happen?
Well, the big barrier is just the extent of money and corporate influence. That's not saying somebody is on the take at the FCC or anything like that. But again, it's kind of in the whole ambiance of Washington right now. Be careful with that. Are you going to get into a big fight with this interest group or that interest group? And woe is me, the congressional elections are already starting up for 2014 and all of that. So I think there's that. And I think that's probably the main reason.
Yeah. So this would be sort of a companion piece to campaign finance reform, or maybe a wedge to get people to talk about some of the other bigger issues.
I hope to God there is campaign finance reform. I wouldn't bet the farm on it in the next couple of years here with Congress so preoccupied with going over cliffs and national debt limits and all these strange deadlines that we have and that we substitute for civic dialogue about the issues that really face the country. But this one is so eminently achievable. It can be done so easily. 3 votes. Now, sounds simple. I tried for 10 years to get 3 votes on a lot of things at the FCC. But I did, to be perfectly frank, think that in 2009, when the control of the commission changed, that we would be on the road to doing some of these things like disclosure of ads or consolidated ownership of media, maybe putting the brakes on that. And equally important, trying to reassert the role of the public interest so that instead of a broadcaster sending in a postcard every 8 years and getting its license in return mail, we go back to 3-year terms like we used to have years ago, and we'd go back to having some kind of guidelines for that. Like, if you're going to make your living by the free use of the public's airwaves, you're given a license to use a public resource. You ought to be you ought to be on the dime to really serve the public interest.
Yeah, it seems to me one of the challenges is, I mean, at its core, there's this public resource, the airwaves, but we can't really see it. It's like, you know, selling air, and so we can say, yes, we can see the beach. If somebody said, we're just going to give the beaches away for free to all these companies that will then decide who gets to use the beach and how much is going to be charged, I think a lot of people, even people who don't go to the beach, would suddenly be up in arms. So my question is, how do you get people to see this thing that's not visible and to understand?
Well, in a way, they just got to understand where they live. More and more, they're living in cyberspace, or they're living in that cloud, or the Ethernet, or whatever you want to call it. That's where a measurable and substantial part of their life takes place. That's where the communication takes place. I've got grandkids who they come over, and all they do is sit there and look at their wireless the whole time they're at my house. So I think there's hope that they can understand that. You do it, you have media literacy as a national priority. You educate kids from kindergarten, preschool, kindergarten, all the way through high school. You can make an interesting course. Doesn't have to be every day for every grade, but you start with showing kids how to use those basic tools of information technology. Then you grow, you get a little bit older, and how do you differentiate between what's a reliable source and what isn't? Where should you go? Where shouldn't you go? What's news? What's opinion? What's fact? What's just people bloviating? And how do you get real news, and where is real news? And I think you can make that interesting every step of the way. And I pushed at the FCC because a lot of people, and there's probably some in this audience tonight, I know there are, who have put components of this media literacy together. They put together interesting courses and things like that. So it's not like reinventing the wheel.
Yeah.
You can go out, and I suggested this at the FCC, why don't we just convene a public sector, private sector meeting, see who's doing what, put up, and I bet you can do it within a year or two at most, the way things move so quickly now, put up a K-12 curriculum on the internet, and schools would be free to use it or not. You don't have to get into this is Big Brother Washington shoving this down your throat. Put it up online. Schools want to use it, they can use it if they don't want to. But we have got to take media literacy seriously. Yeah.
because we are paying a really, really deep cost because of the lack of it.
Yeah. And I'm sure there's a lot of people that didn't know. I didn't know the specifics of it, actually, until I got to read some of your op-eds earlier today that, you know, in exchange for having the right to use this public resource, there are public interest responsibilities that go along with it, you know, that there's supposed to be a contribution to local civic affairs, programming for community groups, you know, covering local politics. One example that Univision, I think, was fined in a big way because the children's programming, I think it was a little bit like ketchup is a vegetable, the children's programming was a soap opera that featured some 11-year-olds. Right. And it seems to me that part of the issue is how do you bring the, here are the responsibilities of media that gets to use these airwaves, how do you bring that to the forefront of public discourse?
You have to have a news and information infrastructure ecosystem that serves the needs of informing the people. And we had that in this country way back at the beginning. We've kind of lost sight of that now, but you can go back to the times of George Washington and James Madison and Thomas Jefferson, who were struggling with a very courageous experiment in self-government, and they had no idea whether it was going to work or if it wasn't going to work. But they said, and the history is replete with quotes, you know, if it has a chance at all, people have to be informed. So what do? They subsidized newspaper circulation through the post office. They built postal roads to help disseminate the information. It's not that they were sending out beautifully analytical newspapers or anything like that. They were very partisan newspapers back then. But the theory was just put it out there and get it to the people, and we'd be better off for that level of information. And that project employed more people probably than anything in the early government. Was like the first or second largest expenditure of government. And these are the people also, by the way, who wrote the First Amendment to the Constitution. So you always get, well, you can't do that because it's contrary to the First Amendment. They did them both. They had a First Amendment, and they managed to have the news and information. That was the whole deal with broadcast airwaves. We'll let you use, Mr. and Ms. Broadcaster, mostly Mr. Broadcaster, we'll let you use those public airwaves if you are good stewards of them and inform the people of the country. And that's all gone now. There's this famous story, you know, Bill Paley, back in the 50s or 60s or whenever it was, got all of his news staff together one day, and he said, I want you all to go out and cover the news, and I don't want you to worry about the cost. I've got Jack Benny to raise money. I've got the entertainment. You go get the news. Now, can you imagine Les Moonves or one of the titans of the mega industry right now saying, by the way, go do this? Now, if you're a reporter, you're pulled, you don't get the leisure to really do any investigative reporting, and you're on the air, or you're on the internet, or you're doing this, that, and the other thing, and the investigative journalism is gone, and we pay a really high price. And these are untested times, as I said in my remarks. There's no outcome that we're going to have a happy ending to all of this. These are very serious challenges that rival what we had in the 1930s. You're going to have to make some really intelligent decisions to guide our people through this and preserve self-government in the process. And right now, we have dumbed down the civic dialogue to such an extent that kind of decision-making is not always present, just to be kind about it.
Talking about the civic dialogue, you mentioned before about the internet being the digital town square, but I think, you know, in the past, you weren't charged to go to the town square. You know, if you could get there, you were allowed to be there and listen and participate in the conversation. You know, one of the issues that probably many of us see every month is our cell phone bill and our cable bill and you know, what it costs also to have the hardware that allows us to access the internet. And so when I think about, you know, a radio, you would purchase a radio once and then get to listen to it for as long as that radio worked. And now it's more of the opposite, where you continually have to pay for the right to access this content. And I'm wondering, you know, what are some of the solutions you can think of there, other than everybody should go use the computers at the public library, which my local public libraries, I see a lot of people doing. You know, there's lines for those computers all the time, because a lot of people for whom this open access can really make a difference can't afford it.
Number one, do something about the lack of competition. we have allowed monopolies in telecommunications, in wireline. You've got Comcast and a few other cable companies who basically divide up the market. They don't compete with each other around the country, and they're laying all of this fiber, which people are paying a lot more for than they should be paying. But in telecommunications and in media both, we have encouraged the lack of competition. The Telecommunications Act of 1996 is always taken to task for putting a stopper on competition, but there were many aspects of it that were pro-competitive. But as soon as it was passed, the big companies hauled the FCC, which whenever it tried to do something, into court, and you know they fought against the measure that they had agreed to pass because they got something else good from it, so then they get rid of the bad parts too. Other countries are more competitive when you build out a fiber optic network. You have access to it by competition, by competitors. So you have, you know, rates with some kind of a damper on them. Here there's no competition to do that. So look, for example, our cable rates have gone up in the last decade compared to the cost of electricity. It's 8-10 times as much. And the more, same thing, you talk about the wireless bill, we get one of those each month too, and it's difficult to deal with. So if you can't, and if this is going to be our town square of democracy, if this is going to be where radio eventually migrates and TV and cable and all the program migrates there, you might say you don't have authority to do any oversight there. I would disagree with that. But even if you didn't, you better figure out how to do it, because you can't just say, okay, we're just going to let this anti-competitive, monopolistic business plan overtake this most opportunity-creating technology in the history of humankind.
So you mentioned that if you look at the history of breakthroughs in communication, eventually it's led to consolidation. And
right.
I think maybe it was 2003, 2004, there was a move to loosen the anti-consolidation rules, and I think you and some colleagues said, wait a second, let's go to the people and see what they think. And you embarked on quite a road trip where maybe you can talk a little bit about that and the role that grassroots organizing can play and actually make a difference in policy.
That's a long road trip. I think I'm still on it. But it started back in 2002, I guess, when we got wind that then Chairman Powell was thinking of dramatically loosening the ownership rules, how many outlets, how many stations one corporate giant, media giant could own. And I think they looked at it as the majority at the commission at that time. Well, who cares about this outside the beltway? This is an inside the beltway thing. We'll just do it with the usual submissions by the corporate lobbyists and the special interests and sign off on it, be a done deal. And my colleague Jonathan Alstein and I said, well, we didn't like the direction it was going. So we decided we'd take it on the road, and there were a lot of public interest groups that were interested, Free Press, Common Cause, others that were some members of Congress. We'd go to their hearings. We couldn't get enough FCC hearings. I asked for more, but Michael wanted to give a couple. He wasn't too enthused about that, but we ended up going in 2003 to, I don't know how many it was, 15 or 20, and by the time I left the FCC, I think maybe 50 or 60 or so. I don't know. I've lost count. I used to have a T-shirt that had a lot of them on the back of the T-shirt. But what happened as a result of those hearings, and we would meet a lot of times in auditoriums, you'd have 4, 5, sometimes 600 people that would show up. And the FCC always wanted to do them in the daytime. We said, no, let's do it at night when real people are in the job and they can actually come. They said they'd come, and they'd stay until 12 and 1 o'clock. And it wasn't red state, it wasn't blue state, it wasn't liberal, conservative, Republican, or Democrat. It was a lot of people would come out who said, I know something is wrong with the news that I'm getting. I know that my ethnic group or diversity group is not being covered. I know just by local news what's happening here, the issues I'm interested in not being covered. So lo and behold, 3 million people, and this was before the internet really got into high gear, 3 million people contacted the FCC and Congress. And 99.9% of them said, we don't want any part of this. We don't like this. And it was at that point that the Senate voted twice to overturn the rules of Chairman Powell pushed through the commission. And the House voted in a little different fashion. By the time they could reconcile it, the courts had said, you can't do this. You haven't really analyzed the ramifications of this. You haven't talked about how minorities and diversity communities are accepted. So we overcame that inside the Beltway mentality, and we showed that even in this age when money has so much outrageous influence, the people, Citizens United, small c, small e, Citizens United, can still make a difference. And that's why I said it's just, that's the way systemic reform always comes. I spent lots of years in Washington hoping that from the top down you can do some good things, and you can do some good things. But they're really systemic stuff. If it's civil rights or labor or women's rights or in the earlier days abolition, that all comes from the grassroots up. So that's why I'm busy trying to energize that grassroots dialogue. And it's very difficult to do when the media that you're talking about and the media at the core of the problem doesn't want to cover the issue because you're talking about them. And it's their ox being gored. So in these many hearings I would go to, if you went into a town that was controlled by consolidated media, they wouldn't say anything about your coming. They wouldn't talk about that meeting that 500 or 600 people came to. They wouldn't cover it. But you went to a town that still had some independent journalists or independent newspaper, independent television stations, they'd cover it all over the place. And if a member of Congress or somebody else has a meeting in a town in Vermont or South Carolina or something like that, and all these people come out, 500, 600 people, that's kind of newsworthy. They just ignore it. So how do you get your message across? That's the challenge, and that's my point. How do you get it across when media doesn't want to cover it?
Well, and maybe one of the strategies you talked before about this new campaign you're launching, Promises to Keep, and, you know, I have to say I think most of the people in this room would probably agree when I read a bunch of your op-eds earlier today, I thought, who could possibly disagree with you? And then I got to the last one, and here was quotes from President Obama, you know, totally on board. But apparently he's been on board, but that train hasn't left the station yet in terms of what he's been doing. So why do you think that is, and how do you think?
Well, I hope he's on board, but I had a lot of letters in my file as an FCC commissioner from Senator Obama, sometimes signed by just him, sometimes by he and Senator Kerry, or he and Senator Durbin and some others who, and a statement when we had a hearing in Chicago about the Comcast-NBCU merger that Barack Obama submitted saying, we have to reassert the public interest. We can't loosen any ownership rules until we really understand the repercussions, and let's understand where we're going and make the media serve the public interest. So, in my charitable moments, I am hoping that the second term will see that part of his platform really teed up and addressed, because I think it needs to be. But again, just to make sure, we're going to try to put some pressure on through this problem, because those were promises and pledges to the American people, and those promises have to be kept if we're going to sustain a civic dialogue that fits the needs of the nation and the character of the people.
So I have endless questions, but I'm sure you guys would like to ask some questions too. Yeah. Oh, yes, please.
Hi,
say who you are when you.
Hi, I'm Jay Roman, Chair of Film and Media Studies at Hunter. My question is, you know, at one time, a broadcast license was viewed as a license to print money. When we transitioned in this country from an analog to a digital system of broadcasting, all the licensees, the broadcast licensees, were given an additional channel, which was a digital channel. So why was that given away for free? Why, at the time, there was somewhat of an outcry about this. This was a vast resource that was given back to the corporations, the ones that, of course, we are criticizing today for all that consolidation. So why did it happen that way? What were the political ramifications?
Well,
there?
I think the reason it happened that way was that the broadcasters successfully sold the message that they needed this additional spectrum to make the transition as they built new towers and new facilities and transition to digital. So they did that. But you know, so much of this spectrum goes unused. One of the promises of that digital transition, for example, was the broadcasters will now have so much more capacity. And on the spectrum that they're currently using to send out that one channel, they can send out four or five or six different program streams, maybe a high-def channel and three or four others. So I think they thought, wow, this is going to be just a future of abundance. But it never happened. The only folks that really took, as far as I know, with one or two exceptions, but the folks who really took advantage of that ability to multicast in that spectrum was educational television. And I think a lot of them still do, and you can get three or four program streams and really good public interest kinds of programming. The commercial folks have done far short of what they could do, and it's nice to have that radar scope on your TV if you want to see the weather front coming in, and I'm not denigrating the importance of that, but if you have the capacity to do other local news or cultural events or informative things or even local entertainment, local music, regional art and all that, take advantage of it. I'm a big believer in use your spectrum or lose your spectrum. And I get a little bit upset when they talk about, well, we're going to have all these reverse auctions and forward auctions and we're going to get the spectrum back from the broadcaster. I believe if you don't use spectrum for the public interest, that spectrum ought to go back as a public resource in the FCC. If you don't want to serve the public interest, find somebody else who will serve the public interest and give them a shot at it. But that's not the way it's happening. But I would really, aren't going away. They've been savagely hit. But I think there's still a model there to sustain newspapers. And if it wasn't for a lot of the mergers they underwent, a lot of them would be cash flow positive right now. The broadcasters, when I left the FCC at the end of 2011, were coming in with pretty big smiles on their face, which I hadn't seen for a long time, because they were making money again. And then came 2012 and all the campaign ads and everything like that. So they're going to be players, and they're going to still be producing the bulk of the news we get. So we have that, and then we have new media. And our problem there is getting it deployed and getting it available to everybody at a cost that makes sense to them, and educate them so they understand the need for that, and make sure that you keep that internet open, free from gatekeepers and toll booth operators. And there will be a decision from the courts in Washington, probably in June or July or sometime this summer, about the so-called network neutrality rules that the FCC passed a few years ago. I hope that they win the support of the court. I didn't think they were as strong as they should have been or as well-grounded as they possibly could have been. But if the court rules against that decision of the FCC, that will be the communications issue for the remainder of 2013 and 2014. How do you keep that internet open? How do you guarantee access to it?
Yeah, I think we have a bunch of questions, okay. So we'll try to go fast.
If I remember the 317, it's a rather cumbersome process. We complain to the FCC, the FCC investigates whether somebody has violated 317 or not. And the only time that I recall it being relevant was at the time of license renewal. So if you keep on having eight-year license renewals with a postcard, your 317 is almost a meaningless concept of identifying who is advertising on their commercials.
Well, the actual statute itself is very brief and to the point about giving the commission authority to identify sponsorship. So the rest is in the rules. And the rules haven't really been updated in a significant fashion since the 1960s. It's gone back a long way. I mean, people understood the importance of this way back at the beginning. So what it requires now is updating the rules and updating the process, and you can make that process more streamlined. Certainly the money folks have become a lot more efficient with all the PACs and super PACs and dark money and everything that we have now. So hopefully we can get a little smarter, too, in updating the rules at the FCC for implementing Section 317. So I think it can be done pretty simply. You can't have an ad and there are various ways to do this, identify the top four people who really are supporting, contributing to that ad. Instead of saying, Committee for Purple Mountain Majesty's Amboise of Grain, you say, whoever it is, liberal or conservative, Democrat or Republican, who's responsible for it, or if a certain group pays over 25%. There are lots of different ways to do it, but I think it can be done. It's the willingness to do it. And if we're willing to go in and put that out for notice and comment and change rules, then I would hope that we'd be willing to put a process behind it that would be efficient and streamlined, and that you wouldn't have to wait for the license renewal period to come around, but you would say, that is a violation of disclosure. That program you ran last night, sponsored, that committee sponsored by so-and-so, that didn't tell us anything about who was sponsoring it. And you could seek redress for that immediately. I don't know why we can't do that.
Takes
no.
No, you really don't have any.
That's what I'm trying to jumpstart here, is a campaign to get that going and to get. And there's been a petition to this effect at the FCC for 2 years, filed by Andy Schwartzman of the Media Access Project, more or less very similar to what I'm talking about here. And it was just put in somebody's bottom desk drawer, and we haven't heard boo about it since then.
Yeah, I think she was next.
My name is Suzanne Serbeck, and I'm a freelance writer here living in New York. One of the things that was so striking to me about the 2012 election is, for all the money that went into Karl Rove's super PAC, they didn't win, and they didn't even take the Senate. Do you think that was just bad politics, or that the power of the money in super PACs is overrated?
No, I do not think the power of money is overrated. I was disturbed in the first blush after the election, and a lot of the reform groups saying, aha, diversity spoke. And I think diversity did speak in the election. But this proves that Karl Rove is gone, and the same with people on the liberal side, that money doesn't count and it's gone. I don't think that could be further from the truth. And the money is all, you know, money is, first of all, about financing those campaign ads, but ultimately it's about access to decisions. Those checks are being cashed right now. That access to office holders, that input to writing legislation and getting it through committees, not just in Congress, but in state legislatures around the country. That money is active already in 2013. There could be some races this year, mayoral races, and 2014, we already know who's up in the Senate and all that. The money is going to be back. It's going to be smarter. It's going to be just as bad, if not worse, situation. It'll be back in the same volume, only it'll be smarter next time than it was this time.
Yeah.
My name is Lois Siegel. I have a background in media from the business side, and this is another perspective on it. Having worked at Time, Inc. all the way to the Washington Post, we have had to vet advertising repeatedly, sending it to the lawyers for them to go through the copy, making sure that the slugging is done properly. Why don't the broadcast companies have to do the same thing?
They should. I don't think there's any question about it. And Free Press did a rather lengthy study that came out right about the time of the election, went into areas where there was really saturation of political ads, and went in and analyzed how much time the local news bureau give to talking about who sponsored those ads or what was behind those ads, and it was almost nothing. It was almost nothing. So journalism didn't work there because it's been so depleted and diminished. So I think there has to be some expectation that you do that, and that gets kind of back to what are your expectations when you give that license away? That you really cover local campaigns and local politics, and you don't have to dictate how, but if you're going to get that license for 8 years or 5 years or 3 years or whatever it is, why don't we say now, when we know that the problem is news, make one of those guidelines kind of news-centric? And you don't dictate content, or you have to spend, but just have the guideline there amongst other guidelines. How are you doing in the news compared to when you got your license renewed last time? What kind of resources are you putting into it compared to the last time? And really push. We did that with obviously marginal success, but I would argue some degree of success with children's programming. At least it got it on the radar. And they started paying a little bit of attention, even though they found ways to end-run it and to diminish it. But at least there was children's programming. Now the problem, I think, is that journalism, that lack of news. So I think those guidelines should be news-centric. And I think we can find an artful way to do that that is perfectly consonant with the First Amendment of the Constitution of the United States and is eminently consonant with the needs of the United States of America and the people to know what's going on in the world they live in.
Good evening. My name is Sarah Satineri, and I'm a student at Hunter College. And you've spoken a lot this evening about opening up to the public and grassroots movements. And I was wondering why you haven't spoken about SOPA, which I felt like the movement against that was very much a grassroots movement that encouraged a lot of public action, blacking out of certain websites. And I was curious about what you thought of Aaron Swartz and his recent suicide and death.
Well, only time constrains me, and I think SOPA is a wonderful example. It gets into the laws to change the copyright and all that. And that was a good example of how the Internet can react very quickly. I talked about the 3 million people back in 2003. There was probably more than that, I think, with SOPA and PIPA and all of that. So I would agree with you that does define what the grassroots can do, and the other question, and that's not really the jurisdiction so much of the Federal Communications Commission, which is another reason. I think copyright, those things are really serious issues for the country. I think a lot of the rights to our cultural and historic treasure trove is tied up with very few companies, and Congress just seems to extend the length of copyright from 14 or 15 to 50 or 75 years after the artist is dead or something like that, and that doesn't seem especially in tune with the fast-moving world we live in, or the really wonderful opportunity to share creativity and to share art and music and all the rest.
Yeah. One more.
My name is Joan Salzman. I'm just a listener. I've noticed that. It seems to me that most of the news that's coming across into our television sets is cable news. And network news, which is governed by the FCC, is becoming increasingly irrelevant. Can anything be done to alter the standards for cable news? Because that's where most of the transgressions occur.
Well, I wouldn't think that either source is really producing much in the way of the kind of substantive news that I'm talking about. It's infotainment. It's it's really up to the media to interest the public in the public interest. There's a responsibility there to do that. We don't get it, so, you know, I like to watch the evening news, and my wife and I watch it almost every night, but you know going in you're not going to be informed about what's going on in the world and tonight's headlines, you know, and it's all these things, infotainment, celebrity stuff, dog shows, and what have you. So yes, something can be done, and it goes back to having some of the guidelines that I talked about as a condition of your license. Again, not dictating content, but doing real news, finding ways, finding business models that will support it. And that's always our, well, there's no real business model to support that. So maybe with newspapers, we need to be looking more at nonprofits. Maybe we need more support for public media. In the United States of America, we spend, I think it's something like $1.46 per capita per year. Everybody in this room paying $1.46 or 64, whatever it was, this year to support public media. In countries in Europe, which are very democratic, not government-controlled media, it's $50, $100, $200, $250 in support of public media. And some of that goes into supporting news, production of news, into journalism. So we've got to start looking at some options. I still think that the market can accommodate what I'm talking about. I'm thinking that it can afford to produce that news. I brought this up as a condition of the Comcast NBCU NBCU merger a couple of years ago, and when the folks from Comcast came in to see me for the last time, and they had put forward some conditions that I didn't accepted some conditions and I didn't think were all that meaningful. I said, "Well, when I vote on something like this, why don't you do something to really beef up NBC News?" And I'm not picking on them, but that was the company that they happened to be buying at the time. And they just, there was no concern. It was just off the table. No, we're not gonna do anything like that. So I think, you know, I think they can be encouraged to do it if it's a condition of that license, which is not a license to print money. It's still pretty lucrative. And if it's a condition of that, I think they'll find ways to do that. And meanwhile, we have to consider some of these other options that I just discussed. All right, good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Right.